Hello everyone, greetings from Brazil. My name is Fernando Gomes and I would like to thank Professor Tatiana Volova and Sabu Thomas for this opportunity to present part of my group's activities here in this beautiful conference. Thank you. I'm going to talk a little bit about biopolymers as multi-platform materials to improve quality of life and well-being. This work is being developed in the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, in the Fundão Campus, more specifically in the Macromolecules Institute, where I am the head of the Biopolymers and Sensors Lab. We have a vision. We want to use polymers in service of environment and quality of life. To do this, our mission passed through move forward the use of natural resources, seeking new properties and applications. So we deal with synthesis of green polymers, chemical modifications, and preparation of nanocomposites, always pursuing new applications in sensors, environmental recovery, and drug delivery systems. Sensors, why should we think about sensors? Well, because sensors improve our quality of life, they are around us, and nanocomposites are very useful to produce pressure, gas, and magnetic sensors. The sensor markets are expanding, and the pressure one is the most promising. The forecast is that the pressure sensor market will be worth around $21 billion by 2015. But it is the oldest and most historic conducting polymer in the world. It is very useful for the manufacture of sensors because of its high conductivity, easiness of preparation, stability to heat and to air, and low production costs. But this polymer has drawbacks, such as the poor solubility in common organic solvents, the poor compatibility with common polymer materials, and the poor processability. So, PANI is used in blends or modifying substrates. Gas sensors provide a vital way to monitor the concentration and environmental information of gas in order to guarantee the safety of workers and production. Here we are going to show an as developed sensor. The objective was the production of materials based on cellulose and PANI, which presented color changes in the presence of sulfuric acid. We are introducing a paradigm shift because here we worked with an expressive reduction of the used amount of PANI. For instance, when we are preparing this kind of materials by a mixture, we use around 20% of PANI, while the surface modification needed less than 1% of PANI in chloroform dispersion. Here we have the product obtained by this simple chromatographic technique. In the left corner of this slide, we can see the cellulose nanomodificated with PANI. It was proved by the color changing, which was yellowish, and after the modification, it is greenish. Here in the right corner of this slide, we have the scanning electron microscopy of these fibers, and we can't see PANI on the surface. It is because the used amount of PANI was very, very small. Here we have the small angle X-ray scattering results. As we can see, both PANI and the substrate nanomodified with PANI presented three scattering peaks. These three peaks are from PANI. More specifically, we believe that they are related with the ordered conducting island of PANI. And the largest one is around 110 nanometers of diameter. And this result is in complete agreement with the AFM1, which allowed us to infer that the average size is around 125 nanometers. Here we have some X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy results. As we can see, there are two protonated nitrogen species, both in the pane and in the substrate nanomodified with pane. So it proved to us that the preparation technique preserves the conducting behavior of pane. Here we have the sulfuric acid concentration, which can be monitored while the acid concentration is between 25 and 500 ppm. And we did it using a simple scanner. Besides, the best results are from the red and blue channels. Environmental recovery. Here we are talking about oil spill cleanup, bioremediation, agrochemicals, and so on. And as we can see, among them, the agrochemical is one of the most promising. The forecast is that the agrochemicals market will be worth $309 billion by 2025. So I'm going to show you some of the environmental recovery materials we developed. Our goals are related with the preparation of composite materials able to be used in environmental recovery applications, speeding up the vegetable growth and in oil spill cleanup applications. When we are thinking about speeding up the vegetable growth, we must think about the global population versus the global agricultural land area. As we know, we are around billion of persons, and our population is in a continuous growth, while the agricultural land area is static. So we must deal with three main issues. They are the reforestation, improve crops, and interrupt eutrophication. And now I'm going to show you our proposal to speeding up the vegetable growth. This work was developed by Viviane Baldanza. Viviane is a former mastering student from my lab, and she developed controlled release fertilizer based on polybutylene succinate, filled with urea and nanoclay. Here we have the dissolution profiles. This one is from the PBS filled with 30% of urea, while this another is from the PBS filled with 30% of urea and 5% of nanoclay. Take into account the pluviometrics of Rio de Janeiro, we calculated that our clay nanocomposite can release urea during 2 or more years. This is a very good result. Here we have the dried biomass results. And as we can see, when we compare our nanocomposite with a control and with urea, we proved that our nanocomposite is 450% better than the control and 30% better than the agricultural urea. Another relevant subject is the food security. Here we are trying to improve the shelf life of food by preparing biofilms modified with silver nanoparticles. This work was developed by Professor Sergio Tuadi, and it was published at the Brazilian Journal of Experimental Design, Data Analysis and Inferential Statistics. This picture shows different biofilms modified with different amounts of silver nanoparticles. And as we can see, the films are transparent. Here we have some fruits treated with the biofilm prepared by Professor Sergio. And as we can see, they are well received by the producers. And actually, they love this material because it improves shelf life of their products. This graph shows the variation of fruit mass over the days. The slope of the mass loss curves after biofilm coating is about twice slower than the control. Thus, foods can last up twice as long. And now, let's talk a little bit about oil spill cleanup. We must think about that the global consumption of petroleum is around 80 million barrels per day, and 6% of it is transported by marine routes. Most of the time, everything runs fine, but sometimes we have to face severe impacts on fauna, flora, and economics. Our proposal aiming to deal with this kind of disaster is the continuous oil spill cleanup using cleanup tools based in PBS and magnetic nanoparticles. This work was developed by André Segadas. Here we have some AXA-G results. The magnetic nanoparticles present an average diameter around 21 nanometers. This result is in agreement with the transmission electron microscopy. And here in the right corner of the slide, we can see the scanning electron microscopy of these nanocomposites, which presents a micrometer size around 22 micrometers. This slide shows us the oil spill cleanup test. In the first set, we have the test without the use of the magnetic nanocomposite, while in the second set we have the oil cleanup test using our nanocomposite. So here we have the water, the insertion of the magnetic nanocomposite, and all of the oil was removed from the water. This test was repeated in dynamic conditions, and again all the oil was removed from the water. Preparation of bioremediation tools. This work was developed by Priscila Bedoa, a former PhD student from my lab, prepared these microspheres by a double emulsion process. Here we have some scanning electron microscopy of these microspheres. They were used in a dissolution test, and as we can see here in this dissolution profile, the urea released was around 60% after 24 hours. This is a very slow release of urea, and this slow release of the urea is very interesting because it allows a more efficient microorganism adaptation to the contaminated environment. And finally, let's talk a little bit about biomedical nanocomposites. Our main objective was the preparation of composite materials able to be used mainly in medical applications. We are looking for materials able to produce magnetic hypothermia, as well as we are looking for drug delivery systems able to deal with cancer treatment, neglected disease, anti-inflammatory and pH-responsive systems. The biomedical markets are expanding as well, and the nanomedicine one is the most promising. The forecast is that the nanomedicine market will be worth $258 billion by 2025. So I'm going to show you some of the nanomaterials we developed. Here, our main goal is the preparation of composite materials able to be used in the cancer treatment. The idea is a combination of techniques. So we are producing materials which are able to act as drug delivery systems, producing hypothermia, as well as photodynamic therapy. This work was developed by Nathalie Ricardo. She is a former PhD student from my lab. The idea was to prepare gold nanoparticles. These particles are around 9 nanometers diameter, and they were prepared by the citrated process. Here we have these gold nanoparticles after the modification with our copolymer. In this case, we use polyethylene glycol linked to PBS. Here in the left corner of this slide, we have the sample of is nanocomposites, and it presents an ordinary agglomeration of the dried nanocomposites, which can be reversed by resuspension on the ultrasound. In the right corner of this slide, we have the proof of the polymer shell detected using the FTIR. Here we have some molecular docking studies. These studies were performed using microstructures prepared using Avogadro. The molecular docking was performed using AutoDock. Here we have the results. As we can see, in the case of the phthalocyanine and the peril alcohol, the results are negative. So the produced complex system can simultaneously carry both drugs, as well as it can produce hyperthermia due to the presence of the gold nanoparticle. Therefore, we do believe these systems could improve the patient's life. Regarding the biopolymers, what is coming next? So, we try to understand the trends and perspectives regarding biopolymers using text mining analysis. The objectives were use the text mining on biopolymers from 2008 up to 2021, trying to understand how the team has evolved during this period, and maybe trying to extrapolate some scenarios for the coming years. Regarding the methodology, the optical search was performed using the Scopus database. The search key was biopolymers, and we recovered 18,277 papers from Scopus. Of course, the documents from 2021 and 22 were excluded. The titles and abstracts were saved as RIS files and analyzed using VoiceViewer software. This graph shows us the number of documents along the study period. The interest in the talk of biopolymers grew linearly over the study period. Despite this, the total number of documents published on biopolymers is around 3% of the papers published in the same period regarding polymers. In other words, we have a lot of room for progress in the field of biopolymers. So here we have this beautiful picture. This picture is a map from VoiceViewer. Here, each color on this map corresponds a cluster. The retrieved terms were grouped into 8 clusters, of which the primary nodes in terms of the total link strengths are DNA, encapsulation, conductivity, biomass, EPS or extracellular polymeric substance, drug, nanocomposite, removal, and this one, this node, is the one with the highest number of connections, demonstrating the multidisciplinary nature of this team. Here we have an overlay map. The overlay map shows us some items in blue, while others are in red. The items in blue are those with the lowest average ages, and those in red have the highest average periods, being more recent teams. Among them, the most recent teams are in the cluster dominated by the conductivity node. And as remarkable points, biopolymers are key materials improving our life quality. besides bringing us new business opportunities, as shown during this presentation. To my mind, we must keep the focus on applications involving contaminants removal and biopolymer electrodes, because the first one is among the most frequent ones, while the second one is among the most recent topics. And we also must remember that biopolymers involve strong multidisciplinary aspects, which only can be solved by building partnerships with different skills. I would like introducing Bija Dice, and please visit our Brazilian Journal of Experimental Design, Data Analysis and Inferential Statistics, and enjoy the content freely available there. Again, thanks to the organization of this beautiful event, thanks to Professors Tatiana Volova and Sabu Thomas, and we would like to thank the Brazilian Fund agents. These are my contacts. Feel free to contact me. We love the new partnerships.